What do you think, Carl? Thoughts? Good?
It was all right, the bits I was here for. I did 3 weeks. Seemed to go all right. It's confusing, though.
Don't big it up.
Record.
Do not go over the top.
No,
they won't believe you, boy.
You record everything like in a funny order. I don't know if it was any good or not. I did an interview the other day. Someone said, is it good? And I don't know. It's like a jigsaw. It's like watching Memento. What is going on? It's all over the shop. Do it in the right order.
Well, you can't do it in the right order, can you?
Why not?
So you have to do a scene there, and then you have to get in all the other people to do the next scene, because that's the bit you're going to see on the telly. Your days, we had you for 12 days. How could we do it in order?
Well, I don't know. I just think it was complicated. It won't surprise me if it's wrong, if you forgot something now. One of the episodes won't make sense because of that. Because it's all over the shop.
You're going to change how TV and films...
I don't think it is done like that. I think that's your little way. I would not do it like that. It's like sorting out the roof on a house before you've done the foundations.
I've been trying to do it right. Hey! I've been living a lonely life. Hey! I've been sleeping here instead. Hey! I've been sleeping in my bed. Hey! Sleeping in my bed. Hey! I've been lonely. You've been lonely.
Derek's evolved over the years. I mean, I've had him as a character maybe, 10, 15 years, but he wasn't as sort of three-dimensional. Before, he was just a funny little nerd that said funny things, and it was really a way to see the world through different eyes.
I did an experiment, but with ants that I found in the garden, and I put a red ant and a black ant in a jar overnight to see which one would die. They both died. You're meant to put air holes in.
But now he's sort of become a bit of a hero of mine as well.
I think Hannah doesn't have anything outside of her working life, so obviously he's a primary relationship for her. And I think she feels that he's one of the kindest people she's ever met, and that she thinks there's an absence of that in the rest of society and that he should be celebrated.
You know, despite how he looks and is perceived, he's kind and sweet and sincere. He's perfect. It's just perfect.
A dog is the most enthusiastic, is that a word? The most enthusiastic thing on the planet. It just goes, if he goes, do you want to do this? It goes, definitely. That's my best thing. See that? He caught it. It brings it back. Magical.
And that's why I had to make him look odd. I didn't want anything to confuse you. I wanted everything to be a juxtaposition to what he was really like. So he's got to be scruffy, he's got to walk funny, he's got to have bad hair. He can't be that bright. Because then, kindness comes along and trumps it all.
Hannah, same to baby bird. Falling out of his nest, it's all weak.
Oh.
Call the RSPCA.
Oh, I can't call the RSPCA, Derek.
Why not?
Well, I think you should put it back where you found it.
I can't. What if a cat gets it, or a magpie or something?
It's somewhere safe, then.
No, call Rolf Harris.
I can't, don't be silly. I can't call Rolf Harris.
Call Bill Oddy.
Call Bill Oddy?
No, I'm not.
Why not?
Call Bill Oddy. Well, I haven't got his number.
Well, what? This is sickening. What
did he do? He's in a dream world, isn't he? Hey? Scruffy old bird looks a bit peaky and he wants to start calling Bill Oddy up.
What did you feel like, your first acting role?
You know, if people have only seen me travelling about the world, dressing up as women, or dancing about with tribes, that isn't me.
No.
So, in a way, this is more me. I've got a broken cup here. That needs fixing. I've got a meerkat here, a solar-powered meerkat from the garden.
Right.
It's knackered. I'll fix that. I fixed the toaster this morning.
Right, yes.
Pop back next week. All this will be sorted, and you'll have another pile of shit to fix.
But
I don't know what you want from me.
Initially, when he did the pilot and he sort of liked it, right? And
yeah.
I sort of wrote it for him and it was sort of, you know, an extension of his bald mank, twat, whinging, gimp, moron, you know. Yeah? You'd agree, yeah?
We were out having something to eat and he just said, oh, I'm doing Derek, you got a bit in it. And he's always sort of tried to cram me in everything that he's done. You know, he did a sort of invention a line, did a bit for that and was cut out. Since Savitri Junction, didn't want to be in it, but he sort of said, you know, the catering's good. He said, they're doing pork chops today. I said, all right, I'll see you in an hour. So I went down and did that. Again, with this, he just sort of said, you know, just a couple of lines, just have you in the background, and then as time went on, I saw scripts, and it was like, there's loads of stuff here. And some pretty heavy, heavy, proper acting. I'm going to get angry and stuff on cue. I was like, I can't do this. And he's going, I'll be fine.
He was nervous at first. I had to really cope. It was like, I was like the Mank whisperer. I had to get him in and go, come on, Carl, it'll be all right. And I even cut lines at first because he was nervous about it. And then I said, I think you could do this. And he did it. And he's been great.
I mean, there's times when I just think I'm well out of my depth and I shouldn't be here. Because you've got Kerry, who's like a proper actor. She can turn it on when she has to. Ricky's really good as Derek. I mean, you can watch a scene and get a lump in your throat, even though it's not real. And I'm not like that, really. I can watch a lot of films and not shed a tear. Girlfriend's always like, oh, you're hard, you haven't got heart and everything. It's normally Elephant Man and Kez are the two films that make me cry. So it's a bit embarrassing when you sat here.
It was like therapy for me.
Yeah.
Because when you say, right, you've got to get angry in this bit, I actually imagine that thing that I'm getting annoyed about, I imagine that has happened.
That's called acting.
No, but it's not, though, because it's
not. It is.
When I had to shout at Shelley? I was like that after.
Oh, really?
Proper adrenaline rush.
Oh, really?
Forget bungee jumping and all that. I was like, I want to... I was really angry.
You didn't give a shit about your mum. It's been Hannah who's been looking after all this time.
I gave a shit. I've been very busy, actually.
Oh, you've been busy?
Yes.
Well, doesn't matter anymore, does it? Your mum's dead. Well, you've got your ring, haven't you? Have you got the ring?
Yes.
Does it fit all right?
Yeah.
Lovely, that. You got the ring? Fuck
thank
off,
you.
Then. Fuck off!
All right, thank
you. Yeah, fuck off, you know.
Come on.
I tell you what, take your box with you as well. You forgot. It's your mum's memories here, but you don't give a shit about that, do you? Fucking makes me sick.
Come on.
Fucking hell, as if she needs jewellery. Mr. Fucking T.
Just for my own amusement.
On the other side.
Right. No way this is going to go in. Okay. Just for my own amusement.
Case,
this is a DVD extra.
George,
I know it is. I know it is now. Side. But look at that.
Just stand on the bath.
Look at that.
I cannot tell you how good this is.
I'm not sure to say on this one.
I'm actually going to burst. So we're doing a scene on the beach where Derek and Dougie and Kev come down with the residents. It's not a day off, is it? It's working. But the camera crew turned up dressed like Crockett and Tubbs.
Ideally.
All right?
Ready for work,
mate. Ready for work. My mind was stuck down, least the birds all twisted around the meat.
A comfortable 3 feet deep. Broadstairs, I think, is a wonderful place. We've only been here 24 hours. But it's been like a lifetime of enjoyment. Yeah, I've enjoyed it very much. And still haven't finished yet.
I know.
Yeah, nice hotel, comfortable bed, nice bar, very nice bar. So nice, I stayed up half the night. Never mind.
These guys just take it easy here.
This is how they made The Matrix.
Jamie,
dressed again, like we did last summer.
I love down here. It's really nice and family loving. The people are nice. The little coffee is nice. Everything is nice and all the blue skies and everything. The only problem I have, I can't get any signal for my phone.
Is that the only umbrella you could find?
It's not mine. Someone gave it me because we were worried I was going to get skin cancer on my head. What's funny about that? No joking about skin cancer.
No, we weren't laughing at that. It's just that very specifically you're worried about it on your head.
Well, because of this wig you've given me. The whole benefit of a wig is to protect your head.
No, it's not.
It doesn't do anything.
A wig is to look like you've got hair.
Yeah, but this doesn't do that, does it?
No. This accentuates
so no benefit to
how awful
it's
you are.
It's keeping my ears warm. It's about 36 degrees today. I do not need this on my head.
If there's going to be one thing that's, critics are going to slag this off for, it's that wig. And they did tell you. And when they do it, I'm going to phone you up and go, I've told you.
What will they say?
Well, they'll say the whole thing's ruined by a ridiculous wig.
Same haircuts. They've got the same haircuts.
When I first saw it, I thought, whoa.
Well,
and then after a while...
Every day I put that on, people were laughing at me. Three weeks in, and they're still going, look at that fucking head.
No, I got used to it.
But to be fair, they say that with or without the wig, don't they? To be fair.
Yeah, I'd shave it off. Or wear a wig if I was you.
What difference would it make to my life? Seriously?
Your head would be warmer.
Good point.
I've done a lot of media stuff, with extras and the Golden Globes and, you know, spoof things for comic relief. I sort of doubt in that because it's irresistible to write about what you know. You know, I worked in an office for 10 years and I wrote about it. But by then I was in media, so you sort of write about it. The Office wasn't out and out drama, but there was a pathos, there was a weight to it, you know. So you know, I like to think quite three dimensional characters. But this is a return to more of those sort of Office values, I guess. Ordinary people, real problems, and more so.
I put Victoria is a real asset. She learns quickly and she gets on with everyone, and the residents love her, and she's clearly a smart and conscientious young lady. 10 out of 10 for effort. Oh, what's the matter, darling?
I've just never got 10 out of 10 for anything before.
Oh, that's silly. Everything's not a test. I bet you're brilliant at loads of stuff.
No one's ever been this nice to me before either.
Oh, well, you're rubbish then. How's that?
The Office sort of like touched on existentialism, but it touched on the existentialism of being 30. You know, this touches on the existentialism of being 90 sometimes. So there's a bit more weight to that.
I love working here, but I'm always sad. I'm gonna stay though, to help the people that are still alive. I mean, when they're dead, they're not sad anymore. And I'd rather be sad than anyone else.
Once a day, there's been like welling up of like one of the scenes, particularly as I say with some of the older actors, and that they've got such a weight and a pathos and they bring a reality to it, you know.
I kept forgetting that the old people were actors.
Yeah, it was very real, wasn't it?
It felt like a real old people's home.
Yeah, and also so just talking to some of them. You know, I used bits when they were just talking normally and them really falling asleep. And sometimes they didn't hear what I said. I'd leave in the what? They generally didn't hear, but
yeah.
that was nice to use. So it was very real. And that's so important, particularly as a fake documentary. One little bit of bad acting or a bad line or a bad shot of something gives the whole game away.
Yeah.
It blows the whole thing. So, but they were great.
Anything but love.
To marry him now.
I sort of call it a comedy drama, but it's not a comedy drama. There are dramatic bits, but only just like, you know, real life. And it is a sitcom, it is a comedy. But what's different is sincerity flows through it. You know, what we were laughing at with David Brent was the blind spot. You know, the difference between how he perceives himself and how we perceive him. I don't give shitty jobs. If a good man comes to me and says, thank you, David, for the opportunity and continued support in the work-related arena, but I've done that, I want to better myself, I want to move on, then I can make that dream come true too, aka for you. Whereas with these, the characters sort of say what's on their mind and they mean it, and they're sort of right, you know. Derek says things, and there's no difference between what he says and what we hear and what he means. It's all the same thing. He's sincere. He does think that about animals and old people and, you know. And Hannah says what she means. And Dougie says exactly what he means. And Kev says exactly what he means.
Having a party for my birthday. I can choose the food and the songs, can't I? And the music we put on. Can I choose my presents?
Well, no, because then it wouldn't be a surprise, would it?
I know what you want for your birthday, mate.
What?
You pop your cherry, didn't you?
What?
I say, I know what he wants for his birthday. He needs to pop his cherry, doesn't he, boys?
What's that? What's pop your cherry?
Think.
No.
What have you got that looks like a cherry and needs popping? In your knob, mate. Looks like a cherry, doesn't it?
Rude.
Needs popping, apple woman. Isn't it, boys? The end of his knob looks like a cherry and needs popping, apple woman, yeah?
I've got an old walnut, if anybody's interested.
I think that's the difference with this and sort of traditional sitcoms. There's no level of irony. There's no juxtaposition between what people say and think and how we perceive them, which makes it which makes it sweeter and nicer and different.
You're nice, though, anyway.
Yeah, how do you know that?
I could tell. Joan says, sometimes good people do bad things, so give them a second chance.
Wait, who is Joan?
Old lady, what lived here. But she died. She was wise, because she lived a long time, so she knew lots of stuff, and she told me it. And it upsets me just thinking about her, because I loved her so much.
Sorry, bro.
Let's cut there a minute. Let's go, yeah, let's just do that bit again. Yeah. We just have a little ramp, because I use bits and I jump cut it as well. Stage is here. Backstage is there.
Yep.
Cut there. Great. I think being a director is being able to answer a series of questions confidently. It's like being on Mastermind, but you can't get the answer wrong. It's like my specialised subject is answering questions, and whatever answer you give is the definitive answer. Your minute starts now. Red or green, you know. So it's playing. It's the biggest toy box in the world. It's fun.
I watch a lot of interviews with actors, and everything's always lovely, you know, and I just can't believe that to be true, because I've been on so many film sets where it's just been a nightmare from start to finish. Who are these guys? They're lying. But this, honestly, the set times, you know, it's relaxed hours, it's a relaxed set, and just that freedom to kind of do your thing or add a little bit of yourself to the production, that to me is, that's something new and rewarding and very satisfying. So yeah, man, I'm happy.
It's been really nice because there's a lot of scope for improvising, and there is a script, and obviously we stick to the script, but there's obviously tons of opportunity to come off and to try things out.
Ricky, I always admired him, but I was a bit afraid, you know, nervous coming on, because I didn't know whether he would have liked me or not. But gradually, I think he got to like me, you know. And he's a wonderful person. And he's the most relaxed director I've ever worked with.
He's amazing. I never worked with anyone like him, because everything is like one take. I think he's like Clint Eastwood, but with a crazy laugh.
God, this is lots of dried up muff here.
Fuck off!
Like the little catering area. They've got a proper thing round there, like a proper little truck in here. That's where the magic happens.
Hello. Right. You could sit there all day and fill your face, and people just keep bringing you more and more. So that's what's different than Idiot of Law, because now I'm sucking on a cow bollock or something. Whereas here, it is top quality food.
Look at that. I've never thought of even doing that. Suzanne doesn't do that at home. She's never done that. It's sort of Yorkshire pudding with bacon in it. I've never even thought about putting them together. But no, here, the food has been amazing. Every day. Pie. Brilliant pie.
He said pie twice. He was salivating.
I know.
Pie. Hello, pal, what do you want? Pie.
Not pork pie. You see, I can't help it, but that's... I've ordered steak. But this is a little starter. Seriously, if you're an actor and you're getting married, do it whilst you're working, because you won't get a better buffet for free. And it's lunch as well, because lunch at home is the one that you always struggle with. Breakfast, you know what you're going to have. You're going to have a full breakfast. You're going to have some toast, crumpet, a pikelet, cornflakes. It's that sort of thing.
Cornflakes? Do people still have cornflakes?
Yeah. Let's have cornflakes.
That is kind of the blandest breakfast ever, isn't it? I mean, that really...
People still have cornflakes. What world are you living in?
No, but I mean... I mean, there's a kid's breakfast, isn't it?
No.
I mean,
Rice Krispies. Rice Krispies, you might say, are a bit kiddy because of the snap, crackle and the pop. But cornflakes, it's cornflakes. Bran flakes.
Brown flakes, different. Good for you.
Don't try and backtrack.
No.
I don't know why you've never... It's like you're in this world where they don't have cornflakes anymore.
No!
That's fucking unbelievable. Cornflakes? Do people still have cornflakes? Can't believe it.
So, get involved in acting if you like your food. Nothing to steak and chips.
What's your thoughts looking back of the shoot though, Carl? Any fond memories?
There'll be one I'll never forget.
Go on.
We don't want to talk about it.
Go on.
No, you don't want to talk about it.
Well, you do. Come on. What is it?
You must know what it is. That I'll never forget.
I've got a guess.
Farting on my head?
Yeah. Let me explain. I wrote into the script that Derek likes wrestling purely, and I wrote this 6 months ago knowing that one day we'd have to film a scene where I wrestled Carl and he couldn't argue because it's an acting role.
Right, Derek, that's tight, that.
He can't breathe, look, he's going red.
But you have to let him do it.
You were like a crab that had been captured by an octopus, weren't you? I had them all locked up with your head near my groin and I had a wind problem.
Look at the red, and it goes white for a little while. Can you get that? You see that, look?
What are you doing? Right, that isn't even funny. You dirty bastard. Fuck off. Fuck, you're disgusting. That isn't even funny, that. That's enough to make me go, that is enough. I'm not doing any more. Fucking hell.
Oh, you're right, we shouldn't have done it after lunch.
So is that going to make it in?
It's a good DVD extra if it doesn't make it in the show.
It's good, isn't it? Not even for a proper scene. Shitting on my head for a DVD extra. It stunk. When you did it to De Niro on Extras, how did he take it?
You farting at me? Don't see anyone else here.
I was lying on the grass of Sunday morning of last week, indulging in my self-defeat. My mind was thugged on least, but it's all twisted wrong and beat. Uncomfortable, 3 feet deep. Now the fuzzy stare from not being there on a confusing morning week. You would have done.